Hare Krishna. So, Hare Krishna. Just the second. Sorry for being a little late, but Leo, als jullie bij willen wonen, zijn jullie ook welkom. Je kunt hier voor. Ja. Hare Krishna. I'm somewhere in a forest on a camping in a forest in the Netherlands, and we just found it. It was a little complicated, so that's why I'm a few minutes late. And it's kind of cold, but it is nice that you are all there. And we'll be here for the weekend for a little retreat, and so I'll try and start to focus on Om Ajnana Timarandasya Yananana Salakya Shakshurumitam Yana Tasmai Si Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Vistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Adati Swaparantikam Si Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasadi Gaura Bhaktavin Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Om Ajnanti Manamasa. Anywhere on the ground. Put it on the ground. Yeah. Hare Krishna. Anybody else who wants to join our stream is most welcome to pull up a chair and come and sit here. But it will be in English. Yeah, you're welcome. But it will be in English. So, dear devotees, we are here for a little weekend retreat, and the devotees are just settling in into their quarters. And I'm also trying to settle in, trying to focus. It's sort of like... what can I say? I'll open up some scripture just so that I get a connection with some topics. So just wait a moment. Yeah, I think the Brihad Bhagavatamrita is nice reading, but I have to just find it for 1 minute. Other books, writings of Pastor Charles, Sanatan Goswami, there you are. So we are reading from the Brihad Bhagavatamrita. And we have now come to the story of Gopakumar. Gopakumar is traveling. He is originally a cowherd boy from Govardhan, but somehow or other Gopakumar has become he has become he ended up in the material world, and now he's making a journey, step by step, going back to the spiritual world. And so we are just at the point. Gopakumar has already been in the heavenly planets. Gopakumar has already been on the Maharjana Tapa Loka. He's been there with great sages within the universe. Gopakumar has already been on the Vaikuntha planets. And just now, Gopakumar has reached Dwarka. Sri Gopakumar said, I then went to Dwarka. There I saw various groups of Yadavas along with their children. They were accompanied by some Brahmanas of Mathura and were enjoying themselves. Commentary. In this fifth chapter, Gopakumar meets the Lord of Dwarka and hears the glories of the earthly Gokul and the pastime the Lord's annexed there. By understanding the glories of that Gokul, he comes to know the glories of Krishna's planets, Goloka, in the spiritual sky. Upon arriving in Dwarka, Gopakumar saw that the Yadus were completely free from anxiety and, in fact, were full of the most perfect ecstasy. They were constantly enjoying various kinds of pleasure. He saw large numbers of them assembled in groups, and besides the adults, he saw many children also. Pura kvapi nadrista ya sarvatu brahmata maya madurinam parakasta sati zeva virajate. I had wandered everywhere, but never before had I seen such a perfection of charm as that which shone them. Not even in Vaikuntha and Ayodhya had Gopakumar seen such handsome people. Sarvato vismeto harsan maya tat darsanot bhavat taistva krishya parishvakta sarvakya pravare aham. Seeing them gave me such delight that I forgot everything I had in mind. And those Yadavas, the best of all knowing sages, drew me into their company and embraced me. Commentary. Gopakumar had intended to bow down to offer the Yadavas his respects, but he was so enchanted by what he was seeing that he forgot. The Yadavas, who were all as all-knowing as the most proficient mystic, knew at once that Gopakumar was looking for Krishna. And so they greeted him enthusiastically. Govardhanadri Gopal Putra Budya Pravesita Antapuram Karadritva Sneha Purardha Manasa. When they recognized me as the son of a cowherd from Govardhan Hill, their hearts melted in a flood of affection, and they took me by the hand and brought me into the inner precincts of the city. Pasyami Durat Sadaso Mahiyaso Madhyamani Swarna Mayavarasani. Tuli varo pyari upavishya lilaya vibrachmano bhagavan savartate. From a distance, I saw the personality of Godhead brilliantly manifest. At leisure in a fast assembly hall, he sat on the excellent cushion of an excellent throne made of gold and jewels. So he saw the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and he saw him in the assembly hall. So this assembly hall is known as the Sudharma Assembly Hall. It is the Sudharma Assembly Hall, which is actually, the story is that when Krishna went up to the heavenly planets, that at that time, there was the, he went there and he wanted the Parijata tree. He wanted the Parijata tree for Rukmini. And then what happened was that at the time, Indra didn't want to give, so it became a fight. And subsequently, Krishna also took the Sudharma Assembly House from Indra. Now it is said that in that assembly house, whoever resides there is not affected by the influence of time. So one is not aging in that place. There is no disease as long as one is in the Sudharma assembly house, and nobody dies in that place. So it's a convenient place to be. That is where Krishna in Dwarka meets every day, in that Sudharma assembly house with all his associates. So in this way, Krishna is pouring many blessings upon the residents of Dwarka, who do not just have great opulence in terms of what we are considering opulence, such as jewels and gold and beautiful landscapes and so on, but they even are getting an assembly house where time's influence is basically absent. So that's how the opulence of Dwarka is in a way exceeding our imagination. So we're speaking about Krishna being in that assembly house, seated on a throne. He was served by all the many quintessential charms of the Lord of Vaikuntha, and by many different splendors, greater and greater, that even that Lord does not possess. Many of the attractive features of Lord Narayan are also visible in Krishna, the Lord of Dwarka. A beautiful mouth, eyes, and so on, fine ornaments, opulent paraphernalia, and such pastimes as chewing pan, sitting on a throne. Krishna displays these charms even more attractively than Lord Narayan, and what to speak of Krishna's own unique way of attracting his devotees. So Krishna in Dwarka is being served by many devotees. And all these devotees are making many arrangements for his pleasure. Now in Vaikuntha, Krishna is also served by many devotees. And in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, it describes how the residents of Vaikuntha have forearms and have features that are just similar to the features of Krishna. But one thing is different, and that is that they don't have that Sri Vatsa. Come sit closer. They don't have that Sri Vatsa. They don't have that distinguished mark, that tuft of hair that Krishna has. So we've always heard that the residents of Vaikuntha have forearms and are just like Narayan. However, in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, what is described is a little different. Some additional information is there, because there it is said that these residents, they also have mystic power. And because they have mystic power, they can take any form they like. And they take different forms for the pleasure of Krishna. So some of them become sages and are taking the form of sages. And like that, various forms they take besides their original forearm form. That is part of the opulence of Vaikuntha. In Dwarka, the connection with Krishna is much more personal. It is said that there in Dwarka, Krishna is receiving many different residents and visitors in the assembly house. And it is kind of a formal place. In that place, there are different thrones. So Krishna has a throne where he is seated, and his father is sitting next to him on his left, on his right. And immediately right to that, there is Ugrasena, his grandfather, who sits on a throne that is in the front, so that everyone can see that he is actually the ruling king. Left of Krishna is Satyaki. And of course, Uddhava is there, Uddhava is not seated on a throne, but Uddhava is very close to Krishna. Uddhava is a relative of Krishna. He's his cousin. And Uddhava, he looks very much like Krishna. We know that Uddhava is sent like a messenger to Vrindavan. And when Uddhava is sent as a messenger to Vrindavan to meet the residents of Vrindavan, then everyone is thinking of Krishna. Uddhava is a disciple of Brihaspati. Brihaspati is the spiritual master of the demigods. So the demigods are very learned, and so their spiritual master is still more learned than scripture. Therefore, Uddhava is extremely learned. And that is actually one of Uddhava's qualifications. So Uddhava is in Dwarka. Uddhava is very, very close with Krishna. And because Uddhava is so learned, he knows many verses and so on. So what he does, he quotes just one or two words of a verse, and then Krishna understands with verse, because Krishna, after all, knows every verse. So then Krishna, he knows very well what Uddhava is talking about. Nobody else knows. Yes. It's like, if we play that game, you know, then, yeah, it's like I could also, maybe with Jagannath Sutta, who stayed a long time in the temple, so if I say Tating Kampam, then he knows what Tating Kampam is. Maybe he does. If not, then he should know. Whereas those who have not so much gotten involved in that, they may not know. So Tatenu Kampam, of course, is part of a verse that speaks about the mercy of Krishna and how one who tolerates the ever alternating circumstances of the material world can attain Krishna's mercy. Anyway, so Uddhava and Krishna were speaking in all kinds of codes, and no one else could understand. So Uddhava and Krishna, they were very close in that way, very intimate, very close. You could say that of all the devotees in Dwarka, Uddhava was the most intimate. So at one point, it is described, Krishna would leave the assembly house and would retire in his personal quarters. And then everybody from the assembly house would just follow him and would go into the personal quarters. And also Uddhava would enter into the personal quarters. Then, one servant would announce that now it was time for Krishna to take some rest. So if everyone could please leave the room. And everybody left except Uddhava, because Uddhava never thought that everybody meant him. Yeah. So he knew, yeah, of course, everyone has to leave, but not me. And he stayed. And then Uddhava would massage Krishna's legs or something like that. So Uddhava was a very intimate associate of Krishna. Practically speaking, no one in Dwarka was as intimate, right, as Uddhava with Krishna. He was the closest devotee of Krishna. We know from a book, the Uddhava Sandesh, that Krishna wanted to send a messenger to Vrindavan. And he was thinking, which one could I send? And he just couldn't think of anybody. And finally, when he saw Uddhava, then he thought, oh, why didn't I think of Uddhava before? Uddhava is perfect. Uddhava is learned. Uddhava is very close to me. Uddhava is my cousin. He looks like me. Uddhava, he prepared Uddhava. He told Uddhava which way to go. He gave Uddhava the clothes also, so that Uddhava would wear clothes similar to those of Krishna, so that everyone would see Uddhava in Vrindavan was naturally thinking of Krishna. So in this way, Krishna sent a messenger to the residents of Vrindavan. Yes, so, but in Vrindavan, when Uddhava came to Vrindavan, then Uddhava came with a message, and the message basically was that, why are you so suffering so much from separation? Don't you know that Krishna is omnipresent? What's the point? You're going through all this separation from Krishna, but don't you know that Krishna is present everywhere? Right? So where's the question of separation? I mean, the residents of Vrindavan couldn't relate to this, you know. I mean, Nanda Maharaj is thinking this Uddhava, he is a child, he's a bacha, he is just babbling, he doesn't know what he is saying. Okay? What nonsense is he speaking? Right? You know, he's trying to tell the gopis, they couldn't register even what Krishna said. It had no meaning to them. And Radharani, of course, was busy with the bumblebee. All right, so there is a Dwarka on this planet, and there is also a Dwarka in the spiritual world. Now we are reading about the Dwarka in the spiritual world. But there is no difference between the Dwarka there and the Dwarka as it manifests on this planet. So, let's read a little bit more. So Krishna is seated on his throne there, revealing his two beautiful arms for his devotees. Lord Krishna, the ocean of supremely wonderful pastimes, was worshipped by youthful maturity, softened by a touch of adolescent grace. His sublime gesture stole the hearts of his servants. Young adults are especially beautiful, but in Krishna, the mature beauty of youth is made even sweeter by traces of childlike innocence. Never leaving him unattended, this special mixture of charm serves him with pure devotion, like a faithful worshipper of his deity form. I like this. If we just think about Krishna as being a youth, but yet also innocent. And that's something that's rare to find. Yeah. This we see in many of these earlier paintings. We see Krishna of there was a particular publisher who made many posters called Brijbasi posters. And they have really wonderful pictures of Krishna. Like a famous one is Murali Manohar. And you can see it on Google. I'll see if I have an internet, I'll Google it now. Very famous. Murali Manohara. Krishna. Images. Is it here? Not yet, no. No. Well, that is a nice one though. Yeah, that's an old one. Actually. Okay, I'm gonna hold it up now to the camera. A typical Murali Manohar picture. Yeah, you can pass on the phone as long as it doesn't lock. Show it to the others. Murali Manohar. So, in this way, Krishna is the one who is known to hold his flute and stand there in Vrindavan. So in these older pictures, this is one of the Brijbasi posters. So in these older Brijbasi posters, Krishna is, it moved now. What to do? In these older Brijbasi posters, Krishna is like painted in a way that fulfills this description. He has his youth, but he has innocence also. Yeah. But it's interesting because innocence is often equated with being naive. Yeah. Being naive, not, and you know, when you're too innocent, you walk into all kinds of situations and trouble, right? But that's not Krishna. Krishna is not naive. Krishna is all-knowing. Krishna knows very well what he is doing or what anybody else is doing. But still he has this innocence. His purity is there. Krishna. Krishna has innocence. He is, but not naive. But Krishna is completely open. Just like children, they don't need to hide. They don't hide. They just are very, very much spontaneous, unedited. We, all of our acts, right? There's some editing, how will this get across, And it's like sort of the studied look. You sometimes hear about the coach who wears the nonchalant sweater that he has tried on in different ways for 3 hours in front of the mirror, a very studied nonchalance, right? Yes. So we are always like that, editing every single one of our actions. We are always thinking how it will be received, and we know very well. We also learn how to influence the situation. Yeah? We know. But Krishna, in principle, has a personality that is innocent and open. Doesn't mean that Krishna doesn't know how to manipulate. I mean, when Mother Yasoda is saying, Krishna, you ate dirt. Why would I do such a thing? Krishna, everybody is saying it. No, I can't believe it. Everyone is saying it. But, you know what happened today? We had this big argument, and now they're just trying to get me in trouble. Just look at the politics that's going on. Incredible. Yeah? So Krishna does know how to twist the facts and how to manipulate, how to play with Mother Yasoda's minds. Of course, Mother Yasoda doesn't fall for it. And she knows very well. And finally, Krishna says, Mother, if you don't believe me, the words of your own son, then you can look in my mouth. And Mother Yasoda immediately says, open your mouth. Right? She's not hesitating for a moment, thinking, yes, he's lying. But the point is this, is that it's not Krishna's nature. It's not his nature. Although Krishna is known, it is said that name bhaktya pranasyati. So Krishna says to Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita that he should declare name bhakti pranasyati. My dear Arjuna, you declare that my devotee will never perish. Then the acharya is saying, why did Krishna say that to Arjuna? Why didn't he say it himself? He said, because Krishna is from Mathura. And the people from Mathura, everybody knows. Everybody knows the people from Mathura. They speak lies sometimes. So, you know, you can't really rely on the words of Krishna. Yes, this is the thing. Therefore, he has Arjuna say it. Name bhakti panasyati. So although Krishna, in a sense, has a reputation of a liar, right? We should appreciate that Krishna is not a liar by nature. It's not his second nature to lie. Some people are compulsive liars and they can't help it. They lie even when there's no need to lie. Yeah? It's just become such a habit that they lie about anything. Yeah? But that's not Krishna. Krishna has innocence. So I truly like Krishna's uncomplicated, innocent nature. And in a way, it is said, Sarva maha gunagan vaishnava sarir Krishna gun Krishna gan sakir samchare. It is said that all the good qualities of Krishna will manifest in the devotee. And that is nice, because that's why we see in Srila Prabhupada also some innocence, but again, not naive at all. Mm-hmm. Prabhupada said, yes, I'm a Calcutta boy. Yeah? He was a Calcutta boy, you know, big city, seen it all. Yeah? But still, Prabhupada had this innocence. Not, you know, of course, Prabhupada was in Bombay and one disciple came and said, oh, I don't like India. Prabhupada said, oh, why you don't like India? So he said, I don't like Indians, you know. He said, they are so tricky. He said, but not you, Srila Prabhupada, realizing that he was getting in trouble, you know. And then Prabhupada said, wrong. I'm very tricky. Because I tricked you all into Krishna consciousness. but at the same time, we see this very nice innocence that Prabhupada had. Right? Sometimes, just like, almost childlike, yeah, something. Very transparent. That's a child. Child's very transparent. And that is very nice. So that's how we can understand Krishna as a youth. So I just elaborated on that point because I really like that. Let me just read a few more things. Young adults are especially beautiful, but in Krishna, the mature beauty of youth is made even sweeter by traces of childlike innocence. Never leaving it unattended, this special mixture of charm serves him with pure devotion, like a faithful worshiper of his deity form. Since the devotees in Dwarka are Krishna's dearest servants, they can enjoy seeing his beauty constantly. And whereas devotees of Vishnu see their Lord with four arms, the more intimate among the residents of Dwarka generally see him with only two. Gopakumar saw how Krishna smiles, his pleasant words, his sidelong glances, and the movement of his eyebrows charmed the Dwarka Vasis in the Sudharma Hall. Only devotees favored by the Lord can know the effect on the heart of such gestures, for it cannot be adequately described in words. The eternally deep ocean of Krishna's playful pastimes goes beyond the limiting power of words and the mind. In this narration, Gopu Kumar can only hint at such charms.
Yeah.
Yeah, for us also, of course. Get back on 1 second. This, if you have no hair, then this head doesn't work. There's always problems with it. When I shave and stuff. Let's see. So, okay. Anyway, so Gopu Kumar is now seeing Krishna there in Dwarka, and it's not anything that we can imagine. It is an experience that goes beyond anything we've experienced so far. I mean, I guess all of us have seen some amazing sights, beautiful places, things that really impressed us. But nothing that we could have seen in this world can compare to Krishna. So nothing we've experienced so far had that depth of overwhelming beauty, although we may have seen things that really impressed us. But nothing is as deeply impressive as the beauty of Krishna. And therefore, everything becomes so such an experience. And nothing is casual. Sometimes people say, oh, my grandmother, she hears Krishna's ankle bells regularly as he comes up the stairs of the house. But if you really hear Krishna's ankle bells, then that's like something inconceivable. Yeah, that would be a sound like you never heard. Right? That would be the mother of all sounds, you know. That would be like the perfection of sound. Like as a musician, if you would hear Krishna's, have a musician sitting opposite of me, if you would hear Krishna's ankle bells, that would put all symphonies and whatever we've heard so far out of business. You know? So never want to hear Bach again. No. Forget it. Out. Right, the ankle, Krishna's ankle bells. So the experience in relation to Krishna is never a casual one. The experience in relation to Krishna is always deeply touching the heart. Seeing Krishna, hearing Krishna, smelling Krishna. That is why there's a description in the Bhagavatam. Sorry, of Narada Muni. And when Narada gets the darshan of the Lord, then his senses, they all get activated. They all get activated. Many years ago, I went for a concert in Amsterdam in the concert building of a famous classical guitar player named Julian Bream. And he was really good. Absolutely incredibly brilliant. But also a man with a strong character. So Julian Bream refused to have a microphone. Is they wanted the natural sound of the guitar in the whole concert building. So, and the whole place was full. And I was not sitting on the first row. And you cannot believe what it was like. People were sitting and it was not allowed to breathe. If anyone dared to scrape his throat, he could be shot for less. Right? And the slightest noise, and really, at that time, people closed their eyes and they just became all ear, you know? They had an ear like as big as an elephant, right? On the side of their head, a huge ear. And it's just like all the energy of their consciousness was in the ear. And we even have a saying in English like that. I am all ear. That means I'm very attentively listening to what. And that's how it was. We were all sitting there, me too, you know. And although it was, you really had to concentrate. It was brilliant. Oh, it was so good. But anyway, that was it. So imagine that and you're all ear when you hear Krishna. But when you see Krishna at the same time, you're all eye also. Okay? Then you smell the scent of Krishna's lotus feet and you're all nose. Okay? You get a huge nose as well. So your eyes become big, big ears, big nose. All the senses are just growing and become very large in the sense that they completely overwhelm the consciousness. And this is what happened with Narada Muni, that all his senses were fighting with each other. You know, like his eyes wanted the attention, but then his ears, and then his nose. And in this way, his senses were competing with each other. And Narada became completely confused by that. He didn't know how to deal with it anymore. And it's very interesting, you know, how it is described. Right? So such descriptions of seeing Krishna. And yes, we of course are just outsiders, you know, and we just peek in, you know, like maybe just there's a little, you can sort of like just look inside what's going on. We get a peek into Krishna's world. we heard a description of Srila Prabhupada's last visit to the Bhaktivedanta Manor. Srila Prabhupada was not in good health. It was 1977. And so Srila Prabhupada was upstairs in his room. And at the time, because his health wasn't good, all the devotees were just tiptoeing, you know. They were all like very quietly moving around the Bhaktivedanta Manor. And then the German devotees arrived. And the German devotees, they were very loud, you know. At that time, the German devotees were the biggest book distributors in ISKCON. Yes. So they came in and they made a lot of noise and everyone said, quiet, 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 Prabhupada is not well. And they said, you know, like, we've come to see Prabhupada. No, 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 he's not seeing anyone. No, 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 he's not well. So, no, no, no. He'll surely want to see us. You're the Sankirtan devotee. And just ask him. And they did. And Prabhupada said, oh, yes, send them up. The Sankirtan devotees, the distributors. So they came up. And Manidhar, he describes the experience. And he said, when he came into Prabhupada's room, it was as if he looked over the wall of Vaikuntha. He just looked over the wall of Vaikuntha and looked straight into the spiritual world. And Prabhupada was sitting there in the spiritual world. Yeah. So that is kind of when Krishna is there, when in seeing Krishna, it is just an amazing experience. And so Gopal Kumar was completely, completely absorbed, in seeing Krishna and every aspect of Krishna. this. It is said only later, much later, after having been there in Dwarka for some time, did Gopakumar begin to feel that Dwarka was in some way, that there was something lacking. First of all, the residents of Dwarka were saying, "My dear Gopakumar, why don't you put on some nice clothes? You know, I mean, you're just wearing this old rugged dhoti and, you know, and just whatever, this simple dress. And here in Dwarka, everyone can have a beautiful dress. Why don't you just wear wonderful clothes like Krishna and like all of us? Now that you are here, now that you're, it is natural." But Gopakumar felt a little bit uncomfortable. He liked that identity of the cowherd boy, and he gradually began to appreciate. Up to the line. So, yeah, Gopakumar, he began to he appreciated his cowherd boy identity, and he began to experience the distance that was there in Vaikuntha, and he was not satisfied. That's when he desired to go to Vrindavan. That simple intimacy with Krishna. So this is wonderful. As you can see, that the Brihad Bhagavatamrita is a very, very beautiful book. And I've spoken from it before in our meetings, right? And I decided to just speak from it again because I know it's full of sweetness. It's just so filled with sweetness that you just start reading and it gets sweet, you know, wherever you read. That's amazing. It's really one of those books where you just, and it's deep. It's always very, it's very deep. Sanatana Goswami, obviously the purpose is to establish that the love of God of Vrindavan is the topmost. I mean, that's clear. That's what he's aiming at and that's what's coming out. But then he goes step by step to all the different features of the Lord. And it's very, very, very beautiful. Very nice. Let me open it up a little more and give it a scroll. So I'm just let it scroll a bit and see what happens now. Uddhava quickly came forward, delighted to see me in the dress of a cowherd boy. He carefully lifted me from the ground, brought me back to full awareness, and led me to the Lord's side with both hands. Since Uddhava has a special attachment to the residents of Gokul, he at once recognized Gopakumar's dress, and he quickly left his service of massaging Krishna's feet to carry out the Lord's word. Then the Lord wanted to lift me up and draw me to his side, placed his feet close to me, and O Uddhava, with his own hand, firmly touched my head to those lotus feet. In all of Gopakumar's travels throughout the material and spiritual worlds, he never experienced such mercy from the Supreme Lord. He get his head directly placed at the feet of the Lord, but it's not there. The Lord of my life then stroked me with his lotus hands, and if to cleanse each of my limbs, he took the flute from my hand, looked at it, and apparently distressed, remained silent, shedding tears. Commentary. Although Krishna was in the august assembly of royalty, he was unable to check his emotions when Gopakumar came near. Krishna surely knows how to deal lovingly with his devotees. And in front of the Yadava princes, he tried his best to control himself. But it was obvious he was becoming agitated. The next moment he asked, Is all well with you? Is your health good? I hope the place you came from is free from any influence of misfortune. While speaking this way, he again began to feel disturbed, and Uddhava had to calm him. As soon as Uddhava saw ecstatic symptoms appear in Krishna's body, such as tears and choking of the voice, he took steps to calm the Lord. Krishna's agitation was caused by the questions he had asked about Gopakumar's hometown. Strictly speaking, inauspicious forces cannot enter the Dwarka of Vaikuntha, where Gopakumar was present. They can enter only the Vrindavan and Dwarka on earth, but Sri Krishna is always in the mood of his abodes on earth, which are ultimately identical with his abodes in the spiritual sky. See, Narada will later elaborate on this esoteric truth. It's very interesting how somehow or other earth is a model for the spiritual world. That's an interesting point, because the spiritual world is the eternal abode. So, generally speaking, the material world is considered to be the reflection of the spiritual world. In the material world, all is temporary. But then we see that in the material world, Kamsa is a terror. Everyone lives in fear of Kamsa. And the residents of Vrindavan, they have to pay tax to Kamsa. And once a year they go. And when Kamsa orders, there's nothing they can do. Kamsa is the ruler, he is the king. When Krishna is invited for a wrestling match, what can he do? He has to go. The king he desires. Kamsa is a very cruel king. So, in the spiritual world, Kamsa is not there. There's no Kamsa. But everyone talks about Kamsa because he lives in Mathura. So the idea of Kamsa is present in the spiritual world. So that's very interesting. So some of the evil elements, right, in Krishna's pastimes, like Kamsa is obviously an evil force. In the material pastimes, in the material Boma Vrindavan, they're physically present. The demons are physically present. Kamsa is physically present. But in Golok, they're just ideas. And it's like, it's interesting. So there is a Kamsa somewhere in Mathura, and there is a rumor that Kamsa is coming. Right? There's a rumor Kaliya is back. But all these are rumors. And then in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita is described the Kaliya came really back. He was really back. But what happened was Krishna put reins through all the noses of Kaliya. Kaliya has many hoods, big snake with many hoods. So he put reins through the noses, and then all the cowherd boys got on the back together with Krishna, and they were racing up and down the Yamuna. Because, after all, Kaliya has a competitive relationship with Garuda. And Garuda is the carrier of the Lord. When Krishna then danced on the hoods of Kaliya, in one sense, Kaliya also became the carrier of the Lord, because he was carrying the Lord on his hoods. Therefore, Kaliya is also one of the carriers of the Lord. Just as like someone may have different vehicles. You know, you see some, recently I was in Croatia on a camping, and we had a good, it's like an exhibition of mobile homes. And we looked at them all, and there was one that was enormous, you know. So many mobile homes, right, as you see them, they have a little attachment, and the bicycles are on there. But this one had the motorbikes on there, you know. There was even one, a very big one, that had motorbikes, and then had a little trailer with a small car on it as well. You know, it's a bike. Huh? They had a little car, so they can drive around town in the little car. And this huge, enormous mobile home it was. It was a whopper of a mobile home. So it was very interesting. So like this, we can, we have our different vehicles, you know. We have a big car, motorbike, small. So Krishna naturally has a huge array of vehicles, naturally. And so Kaliya is one of them. Kaliya is one of the vehicles. But only in the spiritual world is that fully manifested. Anyway, it's interesting how this relationship is there between the pastimes on earth and the pastimes in the spiritual world. And of course, we know that. So there is some exchange, some parallels between the two, some exchange and some unique tastes in the material world, with children present. Whereas we hear that in Goloka there are no children. It's quite something. So that whole class with children, that's here. Yeah. Anyway, we're speaking today about Krishna. Just simply about Krishna. And I've highlighted a few features of Krishna just for the sake of taking us away. Taking us away from this temporary material world where we are always busy with making temporary arrangements, a cup of tea. Europe has been raining and flooding, at least in the areas where we were around Radadish. It is all flooded, and part of Germany, it's partially flooded, and I had to drive around the flood this morning to make it to the Netherlands, and it's just so all that rain made it cold also. So it's kind of that's why I've got my winter outfit on now, and just to although it's summer, but you know, European summer. Don't trust it. Right? Enjoy it for as long as it lasts. That's mostly, except when you go south. Yes. Anyhow, so we spent a little time just talking about Krishna, forgetting about the three modes of material nature, forgetting about the age of Kali, forgetting all distractions that are not at all meaningful, and understanding that, yes, when we hear about how Krishna attracts the heart of and overwhelms the senses of his devotees, let me think about that a little, and we can just appreciate how much Krishna is the reservoir of all pleasure, and how amazing it must be to actually see Krishna. Yes. So our desire to see Krishna is increasing. Srila Prabhupada explained that we should increase our desire to see Krishna, our desire to be with Krishna. By hearing about Krishna's amazing qualities. It is said that we were chanting today in the street, in a relatively smaller city, and still a city though. And we were in the middle of the shopping street, and that's why I stood in one spot for a while, because I thought otherwise If we walk up and down, we'll finish the shopping street in no time. Right? And then what? You know, so I just thought, okay. And then there was just in the middle of town, there was an empty building, which is perfect because if you stand in front of a shop, then usually after 10 minutes, the shopkeeper comes out and asks you to move and so on. So this was, it was just a setup for us, you know, perfect. So we stood there in front of that shop. And yeah, then you see the people coming by. And of course, they look at us, you know, the monkeys in the zoo. And but the monkeys in the zoo are also looking at them, you know. And who is really in the zoo, right? You know, are the monkeys in the zoo or are the people outside in the zoo? That is a question, right? So we were looking at the zoo, yes, seeing all these people there. And I saw some of the people that took some interest, right? Some people were just curious, you could see. Some were curious, you know. And it says, Chaturvida bhajantamam, jana sukhitunya arjuna. There are four types of people that approach Krishna. Artu yigyasu arteti jnani sabharatir sabha. It is said those who are looking for material wealth, for an improvement of their material conditions, those who are distressed, those who are curious, and those who are looking for knowledge. These are the people that are attracted to Krishna. So I saw that a little bit. I was thinking, oh yes, these are the curious ones. Nice. And then some people were talking for a long time to the devotees. They clearly wanted to know more about it. As soon as we started, there was one lady. She wanted to know everything. She was so interested that I even stopped the kirtan for a moment because she asked me, and then I thought, look, now if I choose between the lady and leaving the kirtan, then at least I spoke a few words and just referred her to someone else, just because she was so eager that she really wanted to know, what is this? Who are you? Are you, you know? I said, Hare Krishna. Oh, yes. She wanted to know. She wasn't like, oh. No, there was no, nothing. She was very, very open, very favorable. So this is nice. And that is the nice thing, yes, to see how even in the material world, Krishna pierces the bubble that covers the material world. When we look at the original Srimad Bhagavatam from Srila Prabhupada, which he brought with him from India to America in his trunks and the Jaladutta, then the book is hardbound. It is a hardbound cover, and as is traditionally the case, it has a dust jacket, you know, a cover of that hard balancing. And on the cover, on the inside, well, Srila Prabhupada has made a sketch and the drawing of the cover of the dust jacket is based on Prabhupada's drawing. And it shows a Goloka, it shows the Vaikuntha planets, and it shows the material world. And on the inside cover of the dust jacket, there's a description of the material world. And it is there that Srila Prabhupada describes. Yeah, we have it there. It is there that Srila Prabhupada describes the nature of the material world, and that the material world is actually the spiritual world. And that it is just a portion of the spiritual world which is covered as if by a cloud of illusory energy, like that. So yes, this is what is happening. We have been discussing about Krishna, and we are living in this material world, which is actually the spiritual world, but we forgot. And we are being reminded, but we don't fully believe it yet, that we are already in the spiritual world. We don't 100% believe it, but some of that spiritual effulgence is coming to the cloud of illusory energy that is covering now. Some of that transcendental knowledge and transcendental ras is coming into our realm. And that is the amazing thing. And that is also what I would like to see. Spiritual realm descends into this material world that we live in. And I try to every week, somehow or other, bring some of that so that we can again and become surcharged, become inspired. And I become inspired from these Friday meetings. So today I am here in this retreat center for a Dutch retreat. I started to speak. Neither do I, by the way. But, you know, somehow or other, I hope that still something of the message came true. If you don't know the language, you can get it across. Okay? Even if you don't know the language, Prabhupada says, when there's a fire, you manage to somehow or other communicate it, you know, like this. And it's like, you know, with gestures. With whatever, somehow or other, if we communicate. So I've made a little noise, and I hope that we could communicate something about Krishna. I'll end now with speaking and open it up to some questions, and then we can take it from there. So I have also a live audience, and if they have questions, then I'll take their questions today. So let's see, any live questions? Nothing, okay, then I take from internet. Okay, nothing directly live from internet either. Oh yes, there are some hands. Maitri is there. Yes. Maitri, friendship personified.
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Yes, I.
Famous. And because even when we do Prem Dhwani, we don't mention Dwarkadham there.
Yes, we don't. And the reason is that we are Gaudiyas. We are followers of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was, of course, in these three dhams. So the movement of Lord Chaitanya is particularly happening in these three dhams. And it is Lord Chaitanya who particularly reveals that mood of Vrindavan. Okay. Now, Jagannath Puri counts as Dwarka. That is to say, the Jagannath temple in Puri counts as Dwarka. And the Gundicha temple, where Yatra ends up, and the gardens of Gundicha count as Vrindavan. So in this way, Dwarka is manifested in Puri, but it is about taking Krishna from Dwarka to Vrindavan. But that's the reason, because of We are followers of Chaitanya. In all these places, that comes out in Mayapur, in Jagannath Puri, and in Vrindavan itself.
Thank you, Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Okay, the next one is Gurudas.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
Yeah, I don't see you. Yeah, now I do. Oh my God.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
That is so good.
I was wondering about innocence, because you're talking about it's not naivety. So I was just wondering,
yeah, I mean, I'm still working on it, you know. I lost it long ago. So, but at the same time, that it is described that Krishna is childlike, and that means that he doesn't all the time is very much himself, and he's of course his wonderful self, his very nice self. And in that way, Krishna of course also is free from making mistakes. He's perfect, so that helps, right? In our case, you know, otherwise you make a mistake, right? Yeah, I mean, we are always trying to make an impression. Like one time, Gurudas, you told me, if you're not beautiful, you should, you could just go for the gorilla look. In your case, of course. But I'm considering the gorilla look. So. Yeah, so it's
yeah.
What do you think?
Is there such thing as getting one's innocence back? Because maybe we've done crude things in life, and then what you've can we become innocent or childlike again, or has it gone?
Yeah. No, it's and as I said, all the good qualities of Krishna will develop in us, and we will naturally become more simple, right? Because we realize that all this pretense in the material world is simply false. What is the benefit of that? Right? And we see that all these goals are false. We see that just Krishna is important. And so we can see that the pure devotee is just pointing at Krishna and just making Krishna the thoroughly become our priority, then there's no more duality. Then there's no more need to pretend. Then there's no more need to make an impression. Then one can just be himself. This is like when Prabhupada started first preaching in America. One person, it is mentioned in Lilamrita, was there, and he said, I could see that he was not trying to impress anybody. He was simply presenting the truth, you know, just as he knew it. He wasn't trying to sort of show to impress people, look how smart I am. No, that's one of Prabhupada's amazing features. Right? It was very interesting that in the mid-80s, there was a seminar given by a scholar, and it was called Unzipping Srila Prabhupada's Purports. And what he was trying to do, he was trying to show that actually Srila Prabhupada's purports were not just Srila Prabhupada's purports, but that he had incorporated many points of the Acharyas. And that actually they were the Acharyas' commentaries that Prabhupada had translated and so on. And that's what he was trying to point out. And so in his a bit, you know. But for us, it was rather the opposite, right? For us, it was rather the opposite. It made Prabhupada even greater. It showed his devotion. And it didn't necessarily make him a greater scholar, right? Obviously, I mean, he took things from so many other scholars, but it made Prabhupada the greater devotee for being just a faithful representative of the Siddhanta of the Acharyas, rather than coming up with some really interesting angle of his own, you know, which is like, wow, that was a really unique, brilliant insight kind of thing, you know, and that gives you an opportunity for your own intellect to be recognized by everyone. What can I say? Type of thing. Yeah. So you could see how Prabhupada had that innocence, that he was just you're reading your own book, and Prabhupada just say, yeah, Krishna dictated it to me. He never thought, oh, I'm reading my own book. No, it's just that Krishna dictated to me. It's very nice. It's all about Krishna. So in this way, Prabhupada had a very unassuming nature. He had that innocence without naivety. So yes, we can also get, as we are getting more and more Krishna conscious, you know, as we get really Krishna conscious and forget all the other things. What do you think?
I'm with you, Maharaj. become transparent and fulfilled in Krishna consciousness. There's no need for anything else. And
then it's really not necessary, you know. I mean, I also like it when Prabhupada is on television, right? In front of, I don't know, a million or millions of viewers, you know. And Prabhupada's not nervous. Eh? You're not at all nervous. He's not impressed. I'm on television now. We are like, okay, I'm on television. You know. Okay. Is my head okay? My glasses straight? Yes, sir. Let me just put the right angle. God, this light always bounces off my forehead. You know, we are so self-conscious, right, of the impression we make, because we so much want to make an impression. We so much want to be recognized. And this was completely absent in Srila Prabhupada. No interest, whatever. Yeah, it's about Krishna, that's all. And whenever you get a chance to speak about Krishna, oh, very happy. Very happy. Like that. Yeah. Well, I liked this theme very much, that innocence, that, you know, the youthful adolescence combined with childlike innocence. I really like that in Krishna. Yeah, I try to show that. You just look at Murali Manohar. The Murali Manohar pictures from Brijbasi posters. Very nice.
Thank you very much, Maharaj.
I thank you also. Yes. Nice question. Okay, I have to look again. I see myself now. That's not the next one, please. Oh, it is Rajashekhar.
Hi, Krishna Guru Maharaj. I was just thinking about the comment you made earlier with regards to the material world actually being part of the spiritual world in one sense. And I'm understanding that in the context of the opportunities we have for devotional service and transforming our consciousness, etc. But I was thinking, like, generally there's so much focus, at least, I mean, personally, sometimes I'm always viewing the material world in such a negative light, you know, a temporary place, its harshness, etc. How does one transform the consciousness to actually have that sort of understanding that, you know, appreciated as an aspect of the spiritual world in terms of opportunity? Is it just through advancement in Krishna consciousness and in a neophyte stage one doesn't see that?
Sravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, right? Hearing, chanting, and then remembering the Supreme Lord. And for hearing, we need some taste. So Shushusho, Saradana Shivasudeva Katarchi, we serve the Vaishnavas, then we get some taste for hearing. Then from all that hearing, our perspective changes. Now we're talking today about this topic of, you know, that we are in the spiritual world, but we forget, and there's a bubble of material energy, and that sort of covers us like a cloud. We can reflect on that, you know. And like you say, you know, at the same time, we see also the material world, which is not just all happiness. You know, what is very interesting is that there's these floods now in Europe. And I was in Radadesh, and Radadesh is about 14 minutes away from the city of Liège, you know. And they evacuated 10,000 people who live in the area where the river is, right? Because the river was going to flood today, and it did. So anyway, and what was immediately an issue, besides that houses collapsed, that cars washed down the road, and so many of such things happened, and people died, and one guy wanted to show off and got himself a car tire and jumped in the water. Yeah, that was it. The car tire didn't save him. He was gone. They found him later with the car tire, but then he was dead again. Anyway, and you know what happened immediately? Immediately, plundering started. Immediately, people started to plunder shops and looting, you know, immediately. And I thought for the South Africans, that may be interesting that even in polished Europe, right? Yeah. You know, the first thing that started was looting. You know? Very interesting in this age of Kali, just see. Yeah, just see. And of course, you're from South Africa, and I particularly want to say a few words about South Africa, that you are now all in indeed very harsh circumstances, right? That the situation is super volatile, that the rioting, the looting is just totally out of control, the violence out of control, burning down places, and just ransacking places. It's inconceivable. I pray for all of your safety, and I ask all the devotees to also pray for the safety of all the devotees in South Africa. And you know, yeah, what a situation. Of course, we're not surprised. We knew for a long time that this could happen any moment, and just need some excuse. And this time it's only looting, and not even straight xenophobia, right? Or straight killing people of other races, which is also very much a possibility. So all I can say is it's time to get out of South Africa. But as you see, looting is also going on in Europe. So it's just, there's no other option than to get out of the material world. So Krishna gives us some difficulties to remind us that we shouldn't get too comfortable in the material world. Then we hear about the spiritual world. And gradually a desire develops in our heart to go back to Godhead. And then we start thinking of Krishna all day. Sravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam. Hearing, chanting, and remembering.
Thank you so much, Kumaraj, and thank you so much for your praise for South African devotee.
Yeah. Yes, dear South African devotees. May all go well and may this whole thing pass over quickly. Yes, my second home, South Africa. I haven't been home for a while, but it is my second home. First home is Vrindavan.
This is the longest that I haven't seen you that I can remember.
Yeah, it's the longest that I haven't been in South Africa. Just about 1 year, actually. I left June.
But even in your last visit, many of us couldn't get to see you. We were already in lockdown. Yeah,
a little bit locked down, wasn't it? Yes. Well, it's everywhere like that. You know what I mean? It's been times where we've all been thrown back on ourselves, right? And just between us and Krishna. All the no big festivals, no big gatherings, nothing like that. No nourishment like that. You know, this here we are with a group of people. It's really our first retreat, right? I mean, like a short while ago, everyone would be wearing masks. Today, I went into a petrol station in the Netherlands, and no one was wearing a mask. And it's looking like, whoa, wow. What's no masks, you know what I mean? I have my mask in my pocket just for petrol stations, actually. See, a German one, because in Germany you have to wear your Hanuman mask. And so here I am, yeah. Yeah. No other masks allowed in Deutschland. Yeah. This is the only one. And since I'm a lot in Deutschland, I have this one, and it's actually, you can actually breathe better in these ones. Yeah, it's like they look very charming. But you get more air in them, I must say. Yeah. And then no one was wearing a mask. No one. Amazing. And we're having a retreat. Wow, with human beings. You know? For a whole year, I've been treating with trees and birds. So this is the material world. But my dear Rajashekhar, we were never separated for a minute. Because really, you know, as a guru, you're thinking of the well-being of the disciples. And as a disciple, I said many times, I've said over the years many times, it is as if our spiritual master is always looking out over our shoulder. And we should think like that. He's looking. How would you chant your rounds if I would be looking over your shoulder? How would you get up? What time would you get up in the morning if I would look over your shoulder?
Definitely, Aliyah.
And so on and so on. So don't forget, Rajashekhar, I'm always looking over your shoulder. And you know, as soon as we meet, I can see the fruits of all that you've done since our last meeting.
Thank you very much.
So I hope there will be good fruits. Yeah. Don't forget, I'm looking over your shoulder.
Yes, Kamaraj, thank you.
Always. Thank you. Okay, I can't see if there's anybody else. Now I'm only seeing myself on the screen. Gosh, my tilak is messed up again. It's like one of my disciples is his dentist, and then I have a picture with a smile and he enlarged it, and then he started to criticize my teeth. True. Or for anyone of any question. That's all right. The time has moved on, but I see Vasantpanch. So Vasantpanch, you get the last one, and then we will end. So Vasantpanch was originally from Zimbabwe, right?
Yes, my good much.
And then
we had the same.
Yeah, we met in the internet place in India. Yes.
Near the gate.
They had all these little cubicles, and I had the audacity to speak to my neighbor.
we were sitting waiting for the terminals to get clear, because at those days it was internet was like a rare thing.
Yeah.
So we're on the waiting bench.
Ay, 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 on the waiting bench. Eh? Phew. Anyway, I appreciate that, you know, and that somehow or other, that waiting bench brought you to this point, and that you became Vasantpanchami Das, because you were initiated on Vasantpanchami, which is such a day. And, you know, it's such an amazing day. The first day of spring, and so many amazing personalities appeared. And Vrindavan is so wonderful on that day that I could not get Vasantpanchami out of my mind. And, you became Vasantpanchami. I hope you are happy with the name.
Yes, very much. Definitely.
And,
thank you.
Yeah, I think because the name is a meditation, you know, it's obviously about all those personalities that appeared and disappeared on that day. It is about how all the Vrijbasis are celebrating that occasion of the first day of spring by dressing all the deities in yellow. It's about all these things. So Vasantpanchami Prabhu, please give us your question.
Thank you very much. So my question is about consciousness. You were mentioning that we're actually in the spiritual world, but we're, I guess our consciousness is not in the spiritual world. Because I heard a talk by somebody saying that location, physical location, is actually very much connected to consciousness.
Correct.
So that's what I was trying to understand, that we may be in a location, but we may be in a particular consciousness which puts us in a certain mindset.
Let's talk about the spiritual world and all that, and then give some material examples as well. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, Srila Prabhupada has included notes to the first chapter of the 10th canto. And these notes are an ocean of conclusions. I can recommend to read the notes to the first chapter of the 10th canto. And there you will also find a description that Mathura is a state of consciousness. Yes. So that is a fact. It is location, but it's also a state of consciousness. Right? And when one is a Mathura consciousness, then one attains Mathura, then one will be there. And of course, consciousness is the key to everything. I have a story about a boy who was in love, went to the girl of his dreams. He came to the street where she lived, and it was Paradise Lane. He came to her house and rang the doorbell, and there was music playing. Ding dong, ding dong. She came to the door. He had brought roses. She opened the door and said, "Roses, roses, I am allergic to roses." And slammed the door in his face. He turned around. There were Doberman pinschers barking, and he walked out of the street, and the name of the street had changed to Hell's Gate. And it's like consciousness is influencing our perception very, very much, very much. We were driving through the Himalayas. Actually, I was driving a van with 9 devotees. They were all talking about, look at the beautiful view. I was driving and looking down 3 kilometers, and I saw even cars lying down there. I was also going at the beautiful view, you know? Whoa. So it's all consciousness, all consciousness. Yes, everything starts on a level of consciousness and then manifests on the gross platform. Yeah. So, indeed, therefore, going to the spiritual world need not be a very long journey. Yeah. It simply means that if we thoroughly realize that we're actually in the spiritual world right now, done. Anyway, I'm only talking about what I've read, because I'm also thinking, boy, it was a long lockdown. Oh, gosh, it's cold now. My back, my front, my head, my top, my bottom. I can think of so many things, material things that distract my mind. But at least we connect everything with Krishna. We are here now in a Dutch forest, and I read up about it. We have good company here in this forest, because there are 8 wolves living in the forest as well. Yeah. So I'm looking forward to some adventure. And if you see a wolf, then you can wonder where the other 7 are. So it will certainly be exciting, I think, the time spent here. And I wish all of you could have been here for our forest retreat. And we are going to think of all the forests that are there in the scripture. Naturally, the forest of Vrindavan. Yeah. Or we can think of the forest of Jarikanda and see the deers and tigers embracing and dancing in kirtan. Let us see what will come to pass in the next few days. But I'm very sure we are going to try to uncover the consciousness so that we come to see the spiritual world. That's what we're going to try and do here. And if you do it where you are, all of you, then we will be all together, surely. So, Vasant Panchami, I thank you very much for your thoughtful questions, usually. I'm going to take your leave now, but it's been very nice to be here with you. Yes, hope everything will go well with all of you. Hare Krishna.